today we are very, very fortunate to have a very distinguished panel with us. They are people who have worked in Chinatown, who understand the environments of Chinatown extremely well. And to my immediate left is Mr. Alan Cohen, who is a founder and a senior advisor of the Chinese American Planning Council. Through his work, starting in 1965, he started working in Chinatown around 1965, and through his work, his dedication, and his intelligence, is able to bring a grassroots shop into a really a prominent organization. It is one of it is the largest Chinese American not-for-profit organization, not just in New York City, but in the whole country. Mm. So please welcome Mr. Alan Cohen. To my left again is Professor Terry Mizrahi. Her name starts with a T-E-R-R-Y rather than I. She's a professor at the School of Social Work at Hunter College, and he's also the president of a very prominent organization. It's the National Association of Social Workers. It's an association for the whole country, you know, the social workers in this whole country, and we are really proud that she can spend time with us to talk to us about what she has learned from her years of working in the Lower East Side. So please welcome Professor Mizrahi. To her left is Mr. Christopher Cui. He is the Executive Director of Asian American for Equality. And as you know, this is an organization that has made tremendous success in terms of its work, in terms of its outreach. It's really remarkable. I hope that he can share his success stories with us. He is also the chairman of the Renaissance Economic Development Corporation. Most importantly, he has raised over $50 million to build 500 units of housing for low-income individuals and families. Please welcome Mr. Christopher Cui. To his left is Dr. Vincenzo Milioni, who is Director of Research and Education at the Calandra Italian-American Institute. It is our neighbor. They work downstairs on the 17th floor. Dr. Milioni is responsible for the social science research on Italian Americans, and he has done a lot of work involving Asian Americans and the comparison of the Asian Americans to Italian Americans in terms of their problems and in terms of their progress, etc. Please welcome Dr. Milioni. And with that, I'm going to start with some questions, and please feel free to join in if you think that you have some additional, you know, some points that you want to stress, etc. Now, relatively speaking, the Chinese community is a young community. The Jewish community and the Italian community have been in this country for a much longer period of time, and even though that initially it has been receiving some, let's say, discriminated treatment, but over the years it has been able to be absorbed into the mainstream community. Can you tell us a little bit about the reasons of such success and perhaps some of the lessons that maybe the new Chinese community can learn from?
Okay, that's the rest of the thing.
All of us.
Yeah,
go ahead.
Anybody who wants to say something.
Okay, let me do it. I'll start. It's okay. actually, I'd like to start by first identifying or defining Chinatown and Little Italy. And can you have that slide? What do we see?
Let me see. You want to show something?
Yes.
Okay.
Because I think it's important to understand what has happened in terms of geography of how the Italian American community and the Asian community have evolved. Let me stand up. This is basically the Lower East Side, and what you see here in blue, is this okay? And what you see here in blue is the old Little Italy. What you see here in yellow is the old Chinatown. Well, what's happened is that Chinatown, Asian Americans have actually now become a new Chinatown. Okay, the next slide. I'm sorry, I'm on the
clock
here. Just stand this way again. Okay, let me try to stand from the other side. Okay, this is a little bit closer. But again, I work with Tom on this to try to identify boundaries. These are census tracts, they're not streets. But the idea is to give us that change of Little Italy, old Chinatown, new Chinatown. Next one. Okay. If we look at some of the population statistics now, okay? In the old Chinatown, remember the old geography, now we have 83% Asians in that area. If we look at the new Chinatown, the Lower East Side, the expansion, which is also within the expansion of Little Italy, we have 64% Asians in that area. And if we look at the old Little Italy that was all Italians, and I was trying to get some old statistics, but you know, believe me, at one time when the Italian immigrants came here, got off the boat, they all went down to Little Italy, so it was full of Italians. But now, even old Little Italy, it's 57% Asian. And if we look at the old Little Italy now, and what is left is 8.3% Italians. Okay, which is really representative of the percentage of Italians in New York City. So in New York City we have about 8.4, there's about 8.3 down in old Chinatown, it's similar. The only thing that we don't know, The only thing that we don't know, and I wasn't able to go fully pick it out, but we could do this for another workshop, and that is how many Italians are intermixed with the Asian Americans. And I think we're going to find a larger actually, the Lower East Side seems to be attracting a lot of Italian American professionals now. So I think this is something we could, look at later. Now back to your question.
Okay. Well, if I can just repeat a little bit, is that the Italians, the Jewish community. It's truly a story of success. And can you comment about the success? And can you comment about the kind of lessons that perhaps the Chinese community can learn from?
Again, me?
Maybe okay. Somebody
yes,
else
yes.
would be good for.
just like, yeah. It's not in the bio. I got my bio to you too late. But in addition to having been with the Chinese community for so long, I have a master's in social work administration, a BA in education, and towards a doctorate in social work. I've also worked with Italian street gangs in Cleveland, Ohio, and I've worked with the Catholic community for a couple of years, and 3 years with the Jewish community, and 1 year with the Hispanic community. I was very active in the civil rights movement and spent 4 years as the director of the Selma House in the Black American community in New Brunswick. I only say that because as we walk down Main Street, I bring all of these influences with me, if you will. And I think to relate to Tom's question and to the map, I think some of it, Betty certainly knows, I think Pauline knows. Now I'll ask the question, for those two people excluded, where is the oldest Jewish cemetery in the United States?
Portuguese.
St. James.
Yeah, St. James Place in Chinatown. Now, why is it there? It's there because the early Jews that came to the United States came to Peter Stuyvesant. You remember Peter Stuyvesant from public school, right? Old peg leg. He was not happy with the Jews who came. The Jews who came first to New York, as Ed mentioned, were Portuguese fleeing Brazil because Portugal at that time, 1600s, recaptured Brazil. And the Jews have flee because they started the Inquisition all over again. So about 23 Jews got on a boat, a French frigate, and came to New York in the early 1600s. Already the establishment of the Dutch colony was there. It was in Wall Street. Wall Street had that wall around it. That's why we call it Wall Street. But Peter Stuyvesant, not liking the Jews, said that they could not be buried within the walls of the community. So he sent them outside the community to the little synagogue on Sham Square, which was far away at that particular time. It was a rural area. In addition, the Jews were not allowed to serve in the guard service. The community was being attacked by Indians and also by the European powers, and they had a civil guard system around the walls. Jews were not allowed to serve. And they still have paid taxes to the government. And the Jewish community, that small Jewish community, was upset about this. So they organized, and they petitioned the Royal Dutch Company in Holland to rescind this order and allow them to serve in the National Guard. Well, this struggle with Peter Stuyvesant went on for about 4 years, and eventually the Jewish community won, and they were allowed to serve in the Guard service. But begin to point this out because it really is relevant to our discussion today. In the early part of the 18th century, more Jews began to come into the new colonies, began to settle in Charleston, Philadelphia, Boston, Newport, and set up their own little communities there. And the reason that they came, and the reasons that immigrants continued to come, including the Italian immigrants, all the immigrants that came, was an opportunity for religious freedom. Jews have been persecuted for thousands of years in Europe. They were looking for a place where they could come and practice their religion without fear, without being killed. Some of you know, I'll go back a little bit, to Christopher Columbus. Remember when Christopher Columbus discovered America? You remember the year? Okay, if you remember a couple of years ago, some of the Native Americans were protesting Columbus's discovery. Actually, Jews should be protesting Columbus's discovery for two reasons. One, that year for Jews is a terrible year because that was the year the Jews were expelled from Spain. They either had to convert to Catholicism or be killed or leave. As a matter of fact, there's one piece of evidence, I couldn't document it, that the money that was raised for Columbus's ship was from the Jews living in the Balearic Islands, who were actually forced into a ghetto and were told if they didn't cough up the money, they would be killed. And it was that money that went to Isabella, and Isabella paid Columbus for the ships. So that there was a kind of a strange history in this kind of thing about Jews then now finding a new homeland in America. So it's kind of interesting that when Jews came to America and they had this freedom, they also engaged with other groups, other religious groups who were struggling for freedom. Some of you are old enough to remember the Blue Laws in New York City. Remember those? I
remember Virginia.
And Virginia, throughout the United States. Mm-hmm. Blue Laws? Blue Laws were laws that you could not open up a business on Sunday. Why? Because it was the Christian day of celebration, right? So it was a day of rest, a day of piety, you go to church. Well, that excluded a lot of people. And just think about it for a second. If we still had the Blue Laws in New York City, what would Chinatown be like on a Sunday, right? What would be New York City be like on a Sunday? Well, those laws, and it's interesting, the Jeffersonians in the 1700s opposed those laws. Those laws were imposed by really very conservative clergy people. And the Jeffersonian group opposed those laws. Unfortunately, they lost. And those laws remained pretty much intact until about the 1970s here in New York. very recently that they were done away with. But the Jeffersonians, it's very interesting in the article that I read, cited the fact that Jews, Buddhists, interesting, in the 1700s they were thinking about Buddhists, Arab people would not be allowed, Muslims would not be allowed to practice and to take part in commerce on those days. So it's very interesting that back then there were people who really felt that there should be a very strong separation of church and state. So when you think about some of the battles that are existing now in this present administration, think about the balance of church and state. And one of the things that has made the United States a beacon of tolerance has been that separation of church and state. Now, a lot of people get upset about that. They think that, well, you know, if you fight, you fight the prayers in the school, you know, people get upset. Very frequently, you'll see that somebody will complain about a creche during Christmas time or a Jewish menorah in a public school. It doesn't seem like much, but really, it's an opening. And Jews have been very sensitive to this kind of opening because in the past, they have been persecuted by the government. And this goes back to Constantine in Constantinople, when Constantine recognized Christianity as a state religion. So you had that marriage of state and religion as being a social force. And that went through the ages in Europe and into the United States. So you always find Jews, or most Jews, opposing things like this. Now, why do I say that? Early on, Jews became elected to office, and first offices that they were elected to were small offices, almost like John Woo getting elected to city council. 1700s, you find somebody in Virginia being elected to a small office, and somebody up in Providence, Rhode Island. This was very exciting for the Jewish community. Why? Because in Europe, this would be impossible. It would be impossible for them to be elected to office. So they learned pretty early on that they had to organize and that they had to fight for their rights, that they had to become part of society. So going back to Tom's question, since you posed that, this was a tickler for me. It's so important, as Ed knows, one of the things I've always done at CPC is insist that with the Chinese immigrants, that they learn really about the Constitution, that they learn about the democratic system, that they take part in the government structure, because every minority here in the United States has opportunities. But there are always things lurking in the background of people who don't want minority groups to have opportunities. So people have to be organized, they have to be vigilant, they have to participate in the governmental structure. I'm talking too much, so let me turn.
We'll come back to that, what they have to be able to do. That was great history, and we didn't talk about our presentations beforehand, but I was starting in a little bit a different place, so I wasn't going to do the history. I think it's very important that Alan did that. My biography that's relevant to today is I started my social work, post-community organizing social work career working for an organization on the Lower East Side in the late 60s. And we worked very closely with the what was then the beginning of the Chinatown Planning Council, before it changed its name, and several of the settlement houses. And we came together, interestingly enough, and then I'll come back to the Jews in a minute. We came together around the getting a new gouverneur hospital. How many of you know the Lower East Side who are here? Everybody know? So that was a big hole in the wall, and my first job was to organize for a new hospital. And all the people in that community had closed the old one because it was the place people went to die and never came out of, and they were scared of the public hospitals. But we fought with folks in Henry Street Settlement House and Helen Hall, who was the leader of the Henry Street Settlement House, and a whole bunch of people.
And CPC.
And all the organizations, all the settlement houses, Chinatown Planning Council, and many of the grassroots groups which were coming up then for this hospital. That united the community, and that was one of the first times that I saw and heard that the Chinese community, because don't forget, 65 was that big turning point in terms of the, beginnings of the influx of immigrants, that Chinese people were active in a community affair, something that went beyond, but they needed and could use as well. And the whole organizing effort was to try to bring folks from different backgrounds. Everybody had a stake in that. So that's, again, one of my coming back later to the end of our talk today. It would be, obviously, reach for the common issues. You know, and that's another one of our principles, and we probably could have a whole list of organizing principles. Let me just stop there, because my other claim to fame is that I hired Thomas Tam for the job of a community organizer, along with another wonderful young man then who died too prematurely, Paul Ramos. And we really were the beginnings of, we were the Lower East Side Health Council that spun off the Chinatown Health Clinic, the Betances Health Center that's still there, and the Nina Health Center on 4th right. Street. Right. And as well as this wonderful new hospital that was built then with patient advocates, and then Tom became one of those. So we all have our own kind of history of organizing. But in terms of the questions, and the letter to the, that came to us was more questions, we could each give a four-hour lecture just answering those questions. So obviously, right. I'm glad that Tom is there. You know, so I'm going to just take about 5 minutes or so to talk about some of the things that I wrote down when I was thinking about this. What were the differences in circumstances between the Jewish community and the Chinese community, for example? And then I wrote down some similarities. And maybe I can sort of start with what I see, and this is my perspective, my knowledge as growing up as a Jew, who comes from a background that has two different backgrounds, has what the Jew, my mother's side came from Europe, and what you probably, most of you would be familiar more if you ever saw Fiddler on the Roof, you know, that kind of shtetl, ghetto. My father's side, who also settled on Hester and Essex Street, lived, grew up on Hester Street, born on Hester, lived on a five-story walk-up, where they were carrying ice up five stores because they had ice boxes in those days. And he talks a lot in a video that we made of my father's 10 brothers and a sisters in three rooms, where they not only did, you know, they didn't know whose feet and heads they were sleeping next to, you know, just cramped up, total typical poor. But they came from Syria, the Middle East. And there's a whole group of Jews who, just to make this historical connection for most of you who probably don't know, the people who got kicked out of Spain, went and settled on the Mediterranean and back to the Middle East when it was all the Ottoman Empire under the Turks. And those folks were called Sephardic Jews coming from the East. So I had a family that didn't speak Yiddish, because as you most of you know, the Jews who came to the and settled on the Lower East Side spoke Yiddish. They came from Europe. But there was some other minorities within the minority, so we, of Jews, who didn't feel identified either with the Italians or with the other Jews, and certainly not with the Christian community, who also were down there. And they were in this what looked like a melting pot. So here's a couple of things that I think are important. And there's a not, unfortunately, I didn't put them in any order of importance. But when the Jews were persecuted, as we had, they couldn't own land in Europe. They had no ability to go to the universities, a total, absolute apartheid, just like South Africa. But they had, so they lived in their own ghettos called shtetls. And I'm not a historian for sure, but I know, you know, we know enough, and I've learned a lot from my family. What happens in the same way that the apartheid in the South for blacks before civil rights movement, when you have a total discrimination and segregation of your community, you develop the whole set of institutions. So the Jews in the ghettos had very little contact with the outside world, the normal, average, working class person. They were just busy surviving, but they were able to develop schools and everything, you know, themselves. And that ability to have your own institutions is the strengths part of a minority community. It's the positive end of a ghetto. If you see that, right? I mean, there's a, you know, we think of the ghettos as terrible because they contain people, but it forced everybody. So I think that experience of having self-sufficiency and a sense of community, clearly, as you all know, I'm sure that you're most familiar, is that the religion is the bond. You know, everybody went to synagogue. The synagogue was the life of the people, so we had an institution that everybody had to read the Torah and learn, at least from education point of view, the boys, I'd say, we're not even talking boys, not girls, the boys had to be educated, at least in the life of this, our book, the Bible, right, the Old Testament, the Torah. That was extraordinary bonding, and, you know, and that's still what bonds the Jews in many parts of the world, and certainly here in New York, some. So the education. the optimism of the new life, it's interesting, as that Alan and I didn't talk before, but the coming, we can't equate the discrimination that Jews have felt here, and believe me, they have. We'll talk a lot about that. Quotas, because I want to get into quotas and affirmative action and how it plays out differently for Asian and Jews than it does for blacks and Latinos, because there we clash. I guess I could say now that for Jews, I think probably at least in certain places for some of the Asian community, quotas are seen as keeping you out. But my colleagues, my lawyer friends and educators in the African-American community, quotas keep them in, bring them in. So it's a totally different view of the same phenomenon for different groups. So that's what separates us. Optimism about the new life, because as bad as it was, and believe me, I use the terms prejudice and discrimination, not outright racism, but they were absolutely excluded and people didn't like them, and they were all kinds of things when you read the newspapers that I did from the Lower East Side in the 1900s, and you read what they talk about, these slovenly people, they're talking about the Italians and the Jews, and you read the articles. There's a book called Portals of New York, Experiences of Lower East Side. And you read the articles from the Herald Tribune and New York Times of those days. It was the Herald Tribune. And you just white out the ethnic group. And you look at how they describe these smelly, disgusting people with dirty streets and, you know, and foreign language. I mean, the unbelievable descriptions, and it could be the Mexicans today, it could be the Puerto Ricans, and I'm sure it could be some of the stuff they talked about in Chinatown then. You know, it really was tremendous prejudice and stereotypes and myths about the community, which they didn't know. They just didn't like the way they looked. They looked different. They were wearing black hats, you know, and certainly you look different by dress, if not by race. Complexion, the difference, of course, is that Jews could blend in. Most of them, they weren't too dark, and they didn't have curly hair, and they didn't have big noses. Because when you see all the descriptions of Jews in all the literature, that's how they look. So somebody could say, I could pick out a Jew in this room, you know, what does that mean? It means they look like a lot of the Arabs look, you know, black curly hair. And the Jews used to go to the black communities to get their hair straightened. Well, a lot of my friends when I was growing up, pre-liberation, if you will, used to go into Bedford-Stuyvesant because who could straighten this curly, kinky hair? And they wanted to be like Americans. You know, so clearly, you know, we can't over-romanticize that they felt discriminated, but it was not the same. They never felt like they were going to be killed and put in, this is, you know, way before the Holocaust, or that they would be deported. I think that's what Alan said. They felt some safety. And they realized, a couple of last things, and then we can come back, because I know I want to give the other folks a chance. They came from urban areas, most of them. So they were familiar with the urban environment. It's probably very different from the Italians as I hear it and understand it in terms of quickly assimilating. They knew, they lived, you know, in cities and in tight quarters. I understand that the Italians, many more, came from rural areas. They had to adapt first to urban and then to the city. But there was another part of the Jewish community. Most of them came in and did the garment center jobs, all the things that all the folks did years later. They were all the garment center workers. They're the ones who were killed, probably with Italian women, in that Triangle fire. I mean, 90% of them were working with their hands, doing all the manual stuff that any other immigrant group and any job they could get.
Including child labor.
And lots of child labor. But the other thing, though, but I do want to say there was another wave. Because Tom asked the question, he is interested in the success and what you can learn. The other wave was socialism was rampant in Israel, and there were intellectuals in the Jewish community coming from Europe. They came from different parts. They didn't come from the ghettos. Many of them lived in Germany, and Karl Marx, of course, you know, who had been a Jew before his family history converted. So there was a history of political activism in Europe. Organizing unions, the socialist groups, and that's important because the Jews didn't get it from here. How come they are the early labor leaders, right? How come the whole socialist movement, of course, which we then get condemned years later, the Jews are the communists, but in fact we were. Many of the communists were Jews, and many of them were socialists. Many of them were trade unionists. They came with that history. So they came with a political history, or they brought that piece from Europe to the States. it wasn't endemic to just coming out of the Lower East Side. So they felt secure in their own hometown. They didn't feel like they would be persecuted in the same way. And the last two things was that they created their own industries. What's different from now, then to now, it seems to me, is that it was more opportunity. You know, the country was at the stage of industrialization and still expansion. 100 years later, we're talking exactly 100 years later, 1900, right? In the 100 years, there were many new burgeoning industries. And what Jews did historically, I don't know if this is innate to us or endemic to Jews or unique, but they didn't care about, when the Christians put up no Jews could come into this country club or no Jews here, they set up their own. And I think they could set up their own because they had that history of setting up their own. So we'll have our own country club, we'll have our own group, we'll have our own theater. So there was a cultural group, the Yiddish theater, there was an intellectual piece that came from Europe, there was a political piece, there was the sustaining of their own community, there was the religious piece. So there was a lot of positive parts that I talk about, sort of that unique experience in our history, that I think there are lessons to learn, and we don't want to either over romanticize it or oversimplify it. But I think we could look at that and come back to it.
Just want to make one piece, and I'll turn it over to somebody else. Terry's comments about socialism and the Lower East Side. Those of you who know the old Forwards building on East Broadway, Pauline, senior center, was in there for a couple of years when the Forwards left that building. And it's now owned by a Chinese, has been owned by a Chinese developer for some time. It was a church, and that's where we rented space for a couple of years. But if you look above the portal, it's still being rehabbed very frequently. There were four busts of people on there. Two of them, one was Marx, one was Engels, because the Forwards was a socialist paper, and then there was Daniel De Leon, who was one of the old American socialists, and the fourth one I forget. But when the Chinese owner took over, he removed Marx and he removed Engels because he knew them, but he didn't know the other two socialists. So you can still see them if you walk by there. Take a look if you can walk beyond the scaffold. I'm sorry for interrupting.
No, I
things certainly seem to have changed, and I think that throughout since the 60s, that with a lot of activism, you know, in places like Lower East Side, the Chinatown, etc., and the Asian American for Equality has done a tremendous amount of work. And right now, your success is really quite undisputed. You want to talk a little bit about, say, perhaps some of that success and some of the comments about maybe the other kinds of problems facing us now?
Yeah, no, I love to. I guess my perspective, like in terms of listening to the other two and then, you know, trying to look at the similarities sure. between the different communities, I think there's a lot of similarities. And then I think from my perspective in terms of the Chinese American community, I think, you know, it hasn't settled in a sense of which way, you know, we're going to end up. I think that the Chinese American community, which is the largest among the Asian American community, which I believe comprises about 5% of the population now, I mean, our contribution, I think, you know, our existence could be much greater than its number, I think, and it's already being felt. And I think that from my perspective, again, from heading the AFI as an organization, Asian Americans for Equality, we have always seen the potential of the community. I think that that this is a community that has a lot of asset, has a lot of greatness, and the question is, like, I mean, how do we show that as a community? I think that, you know, in the 70s, it was about, like, you know, fighting for civil rights or access. And so, and then also very much is, like, I think the mentality of the community, as even though we've been around for a long time, but I don't think we've been here in numbers a lot, you know, as large as, like, the Jewish or the Italians as long. But I think that in our community, I think the Chinese community or Chinese American community, we tend to still have a mentality that you know, we need to fight for something, you know, or that we are a victim, or like that we are facing discrimination. So then the response is always still like, you know, we have to, you know, raise our voice, and or even among our own community, we're still trying to get that voice out there. Versus, I think that, you know, looking down 20 years from now, and then begin today, that we should see ourselves not necessarily only from a victim perspective or like as an advocate, but I think that we should see ourselves as contributors to the city or to the society, that we see ourselves as builders of the community or the city, and then as well as that we want to be a player, you know, within the society or the mainstream. And I think that, again, a lot has to do with history. I think that history in terms of being here, I mean, 150 years ago, with the mentality that we would go back, right? I think that the mentality, even until 70s, is that people come here to make a living, you know, whether it's an indenture service type of role or just come in as laborers, that the mentality is always thinking of going back. So then, in a sense, I mean, I think that only started to change in the 70s. I think that would part of, you know, being part of that civil rights movement. I think, you know, I think in some sense, Chinese American Planning Council, CPC, probably started much earlier than AFI, because, you know, in the 60s. And then I think AFI, Asian Americans for Equality, the founders came in more in the 70s, and then kind of riding through the civil rights movement and trying to apply that type of organizing in the Chinese or the Asian community. And so I think that, I think that mentality, are we just a victim, or are we going to stay here, or transform that paradigm to more of a contributor, you know? Because I think if you look at this, if you look at New York City today, I think, you know, the Chinese American community or the Asian community has helped revitalize New York City. I mean, whether you look at Flushing, you look at like Sunset Park, or many neighborhoods now that you have enclaves. I wouldn't necessarily call it ghettos anymore, but then we have enclaves that are in various different neighborhoods. It's more than just Chinatown. It's more than just Sunset Park. It's more than just Flushing, but then in Bensonhurst and Elmhurst and many, many neighborhoods, you know. And then you look at the economic strength, I mean, the savings rate, I mean, of Asian American or Chinese American is tremendous, right? I mean, like, we have tremendous deposit. So in that sense, I think, you know, we are poised to really be more of a player, you know, so then we can gain additional access, or that we are players in whether it's a political world or whether it's a civic world, you know, or being philanthropists and all that. So we need to have that mentality that to be, you know, to take its place in a sense, you know, in the society. So then it's no longer just only looking at ourselves as making money and then some wages. And so I think if you look at, for example, September 11th, right, that I think right after September 11th, I think that the community was impacted tremendously, but the mainstream didn't see that exactly for a while. And why is that? Because I think on the one hand, the strength of the community has been very much on its own self-sufficient, based on the self-sufficiency, have its own infrastructure, it's like what you're talking about in the Jewish community. And then so we've been able to so-called, you know, deal with our own issue, organize around, you know, for ourselves, et cetera, and then we've been very insular, right? And then so at the same time, I mean, so for a long time, we have never really engaged, you know, actively. I would say, yes, we do engage. Of course, we go, you know, watch movies, or we pay, you know, some contribution to elected officials, et cetera. But in a sense, as a community, we have never really engaged effectively and or network with the different infrastructure, whether it's political, social, economic structure. And so when September 11th came about, you know, the immediate reaction was like, oh, you know, we need to, you know, voice our concern or fight for our rights, and which we did, you know. I think our organization, I think that, you know, working with many other organizations or individual, whether it's residents even, like people live in, you know, certain complex, you know, fighting to open up Park Row more effectively than some of our organization, everybody kind of like, you know, fight and fought back. But then on the other hand, that's like kind of an immediate, I mean, but then in terms of long-term impact, it's not enough, let's put it that way. And because the language, you know, or the understanding of the mainstream is like, you know, even though you fight, You say this is what you need, but what is the solution? You know, or how do you come up with a solution? Because very often they'll say, wow, you know, the Chinese community, the Asian community, you know, Chinatown is all fragmented, and then it's like everybody, you know, wants to do their own thing. And that's true. I would say that's definitely true in any community, whether it's the African-American community, Jewish community. I mean, I was told, I read some books about the Jewish community after, you know, well, they also have a lot of dissension, disagreement. But then I think there was a certain level of maturity where, like, you know, people do try to, you know, network or hook up to coalition or rotate leadership positions. So then when you go out to represent the community, there's a certain united front. And I think that's what we're learning within the community or the Chinese American community. How do you do that? As well as, like, for example, in Flushing, where, like, you know, we have somebody like John Liu get elected, which is very good. I mean, he's doing a tremendous job in terms of, like, advocating and presenting the needs of not only the Chinese American community, but then, you know, the Flushing area. But I think the other point I want to make is that, you know, in terms of September 11th, we decided that we needed to, you know, start a process, you know, where people in the mainstream, the decision maker, could either understand or could participate, or that at the same time we could show that the community, there's some type of dialogue, not necessarily unanimity or everybody agree 100%, but then you have a process. And that's when I think the Rebuild Chinatown Initiative, that's how we saw it, that we kind of saw that the Rebuild Chinatown Initiative as a process. The process was the most important thing, because the process, and then also how do you engage that process, and who do you use? So then it wasn't just like, you know, we decided that, oh wow, we do it ourselves, but we also got expert from the mainstream and you know, some of the leading planner to say, to come in and facilitate and to provide different opinion and ideas, and then start a process, whether it's focus group, whether it's meetings, whether it's survey, research, and get ideas and put it all together. At the same time, it's not just writing it up, but then it's also through that process engaging the decision makers. You know, whether in the mayor's office, whether in the Department of Transportation, find out what the plans they have, you know, the existing plans, I mean, the existing ideas. And then so then we could say, yes, you know, this is, if you have this in mind for Chinatown, the Lower East Side, maybe, you know, with the new scenario, with the new the environment of after the September 11th, these are things that maybe you can put resources on right away. And so I think that process where we had legitimacy and ideas that are more larger too, you know, like for example, you know, we one of the ideas coming out from the Rebuild Chinatown was like looking at Allen Street, you know, the Allen Street Mall, and that mall has been like, you know, dirty, and then it's like it's been like, I mean, neglected for years. I mean, I drive through, you know, like that street for, well, I don't know how many years, and you just assume and accept it. Just like the same thing Seaport, you know, on South Street. It's like, I mean, it's actually beautiful waterfront, but it's almost like blocked off, and we never really use it, and we just assume, yeah, it's closed and it's not for us, you know. But when we started the process of Rebuild Chinatown, we engaged a lot of ideas from the community, but then also combined it with the expert. Then we start looking at, wow, this could be the avenue of the immigrant, you know. So then this could be very beautiful, you know, like just like the Fifth Avenue, you know. So then this could be the Fifth Avenue of Chinatown. Then when we start talking to, you know, the planners or the government, you know, decision maker, they understand that. They say, wow, you know, yeah, maybe, you know, we widen the island, make it really nice, and then also, like, you know, work with all the groups around, you know, from the South Street end to Delancey, that you have 100 years of, like, you know, history of immigration. And I remember also Betty talked about, like, the South Street, the history of South Street Seaport, that, you know, that's where the tip of Manhattan, where, like, Manhattan started. Then you had the trade between actually China. I mean, so you think about the seaport, the origin of the seaport, as like really initiating the trade between New York and China, and then link that up along the South Street going up north, I mean, or east, you know, that you have that beautiful waterfront that we can open up. And then so it's like you're talking about the Heritage Trail, right? Because everybody accepts Heritage Trail of Lower Manhattan. And then so we bring that idea, combine it to an immigrant trail experience of along Avenue of the Immigrant, and make that really a nice experience. Then I think we have something. Then when people come and visit the World Trade Center like 5, 7, 10 years from now, they could say, wow, you know, New York's Chinatown, America's Chinatown, right? That we wanted, it's next door, it was impacted, and people were concerned, very much concerned. Every time I go around now, people say, oh, what's happening with Chinatown? Not in a way of like, oh, where do I go to eat? But, you know, like when we had these questions before September 11th, like, oh, how are you guys doing? So there's a passion, there's a concern for Chinatown, and people feel that that's my Chinatown. You know, this is like people from outside the community. Finally, they can say, you know, yeah, I was part of Chinatown, or my parents brought me to have some lunch or dinner, and I heard and I read, you know, stories in the New York Times about how devastated. I'm concerned that Chinatown will no longer be Chinatown. That there's like, there's going to be like just a tourist attraction and trap, and then the authenticity, and then the people who live there will no longer be there. So what are you doing about it? And they want to preserve Chinatown now. They want Chinatown to maintain itself with this history and the culture. So I think that's great, you know. So this is where I think we need to continue. But the lesson I kind of see and learn from it is that, you know, we need to not only continue to be advocates, but then we also need to see ourselves that we have a lot to offer. So if we start thinking that we have contributed, or we have, you know, our community is an asset that for the city, for the country, then we engage, you know, people who maybe control resources at the present time and say, look, you need to also build this or rebuild this community, because this is part of you, you know, this is part of the city, this is part of America. And then I think once we get the mentality, I think that we as a community would poise, you know, to not just become ourselves, but then be part of the larger community.
I think that, Chris, you know, you talk about the process, and you talk about the need not to just look at ourselves as victims, but as contributors as well. And that after
builders, and right, builders and young players.
Builders,
yeah.
And after 9/11, the recognition of the impact on the community, all of that changed. But as Dr. Milioni has shown in that slide, that as Chinatown expands into, for example, Little Italy, etc., and everywhere in New York City, as immigration grows and the Chinese population grows as well, then during the interaction with other groups, some other ethnic groups, some minority groups, etc., there are some violence that develop. For example, in Bensonhurst, there has been cases of violence against Chinese homes, against Chinese families. There are street fights, you know, between different groups of kids, etc. Vincenzo, you think that you can enlighten us a little bit about that? Like,
what's the street fights? Well, yes. Let me maybe put it this way. And again, we heard here a lot of immigrant experiences. Okay. And it was said that nothing is really different now. You could blank out that word Italian, right. You could blank out the word Polish, you could blank out the word and add Asian, they add Kenya or whatever, and you've got the new immigrant groups. This is a history. This country is the history of immigrants. It was founded by the Anglos, but the first immigrants were the Germans as the mercenaries. And now the Germans are the largest ethnic group in this country, Anglo are second. The next large immigrant group was the Irish. Again, we talked about everybody else, and no one's controlling us. Who's controlling us then? We blame everybody, right? But the Irish had their own history. The Irish came over because of religious reasons. And the original Irish were the David Boones, the David Crockett's that you read about. They were the pioneers. They were the ones that went out to find the West. And then when the other Irish came, the Catholic Irish, in the mid-1800s, they were snobbed by the Scotch Irish. Okay, so we have now the poorer Irish in the mid-1800s, you know, being pushed in the urban areas and so forth. But they did have something going, and that was that they did speak English or were familiar with English, so they were able to move quickly within the process, and that helped. And even though Italians, again, have had their history of discrimination, it probably helped us to be Christian, okay, and maybe make it easy to go and marry a good Irish woman and become assimilated, okay. But that was another part of history. Now we move into the late 1800s, and in the late 1800s, and after 500 years of Columbus coming here, which was also Jew, by the way, as you know.
Right, okay. Marino.
I didn't know that.
And even though we had some very prominent Italians that became the governor of Maryland and so forth, besides, it still wasn't enough, because the real masses were coming at the late 1800s. And when we talk about masses, the same masses that we're getting now from China, from South America, these are people trying to find a new way. But it's different now. Because the only way you could find a new way in those days was to leave your old way behind. And the new immigrants are not doing that. It was said earlier. This is a different immigrant today. Okay, not an immigrant that has to make a commitment for the future. It's an immigrant that makes a commitment for a year or two. If he doesn't like it, like, they go back. That's a different situation. But still, the same thing. As you know, on the western coast, the Asians had their own immigration going on at that time in the late 1800s. And again, you know, they were suppressed somewhat and didn't really make as much to the east coast, except as what was said, to the trade. And that's probably why you got Chinatown by the South Street seaport. And that's why you got Little Italy there, because how many times were brought here on the bottoms of ships and dumped there to go and work at those factories where they died, you know, like in the middle of the factory. That's when they changed the labor law, was when that triangle shirt factory died. There were mostly Jewish and Italian
workers,
immigrants. Mm-hmm. And then we got blamed, just like you guys get blamed with the SARS, and the Haitians get blamed with the AIDS. It's your fault. You brought it to this country. No, we got blamed with TB, tuberculosis. We brought the tuberculosis to this country. It wasn't that. It was that the conditions put us in living in one room, many people, in a very unhealthy situation, that we got the tuberculosis here, and we went back to Italy to die with our family. That's the way it was then. And just like we can't blame the Haitians about the AIDS, and we can't blame the Chinese about the SARS, we went through that. So now, we're moving up. We're moving up into the system that by the turn of this century, we have a very strong Jewish community here because of religious reasons. But keep in mind, different people, different countries, just like the Asians, just like the South Americans, just like the Europeans, different people. So, but they were here.
Sorry, sorry.
Yeah.
I thought that you were going to, about the end of what you're saying, so that you're saying that.
You can stop me anytime you want, Tom.
But I do want to take this opportunity to ask, Alan, you know, who has worked in Chinatown for so long, and as a non-Chinese leading a Chinese group into such prominence. And so in your experience, for example, do you have some advice or comments about your observation from that perspective?
Well, I would agree with everybody on this panel. I think we're, even though we really haven't spoke, we all kind of know each other, kind of. But I think we're all on the same track, and that is that there are certain commonalities. Of course, there are differences. There are differences, and you talk about Chinese and talk about Jews, and we've all referred to this, but even within each of these groups, there are major differences. Again, according, as the professor just said, the period of time in which the immigration took place, what was happening in the old country and what was happening in this country, that impacted on the immigrant experience. But I will say that with all of my experiences across the board with different religious groups and different ethnic groups, and just as the professor said, everybody feels themselves that they are unique, that they have unique problems. But the problems, it's really the problems of in and out more than race, more than religion, although those are certainly dominant factors. It's economics, and particularly in today's world. So that, and New York being the kind of wonderful place it is, and there's no place else, I've traveled around the world, and there are many wonderful cities, but New York is really unique. The United States is unique, if you will. We have probably, and probably wrong on the figure, but it's probably about 145 different language groups. I was talking to a principal in Queens about 2 years ago about putting a program into his school, and he said, I have so many, not only do I have Chinese being the largest language group, he says, I have 14 language groups in the school. I said, what? 14? Name them. And he went through this list, and there were five language groups that I never heard of. And I said, what are they? And he had to look them up. We had to look them up in a book. Some of them were dialects from Paraguay. These were Indian tribes from Paraguay. I mean, so the country is absorbing all of these people. Now, if you know the history of Europe, history is it's a history of cross-migration through wars and conflagrations and all kinds of things. And so Europe, we think of Europe as France and Germany going back thousands of years, really not true. I mean, it all, if you think of the switching back and forth of the borders in those countries and the intermarriage and the rapes and the, all the things that have gone on to make mixed marriages, but we still think of them as those kinds of entities. And they themselves, the European Union, I just heard an interesting conversation on this, will now, under a recent law passed, has to open its borders, as you know. And they are going to face, they have begun to face this problem in the last 10 years, and depending upon each country has their own set of problems with the North Africans, for example, and the people from Turkey. Now they're going to have to face all the people from the former Soviet bloc countries coming in and from the Arab countries. And basically those populations, up until fairly recently, were contiguously, were basically white, Caucasian. With all the mixtures in. So they are going to have to face this, you know, they were pretty smug in their attitudes towards us in the 50s and the 60s, but now they're going to face the same exact problems that we have faced. Hopefully they'll do it better than we do, and they have the systems to do it. I'm not so sure.
Yeah, I'm not because sure the they same, got the systems.
Well, you know, they'll develop.
Prejudice.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and they have their old prejudice and stuff, and they're going to have to deal with that. But again, going back to the question that you raised, there are certain commonalities throughout all of this. No matter what our differences are within the different cultural groups, within the different racial groups, we all want to be loved. We all want to have a peaceful life. We all want to have a decent life, a decent house. We want to have kids and grandkids. You know, these are commonalities. And the thing that I was putting this together, I was thinking Lantau Island in Hong Kong. There's an island. I was there many years ago before it was developed, and I was there at sunset one day, and I was staying by myself on a little kind of a bay, and right next to me it was a very poor Chinese fisherman, probably about 20 years older than me, smoking a pipe, and we were looking at this gorgeous sunset together. Neither one of us could speak the other's language, but we were sharing a wonderful experience of that time and place, and that's what it's all about, you know?
And I think that that's a very poetic summary of your whole experience. And I think that you mentioned about diversity, and I can't think of a more diverse place than the Lower East Side. And Terry, you have worked in the Lower East Side for so long, and have seen different groups sometimes fighting each other, sometimes working jointly. Can you tell us a little bit about your impression of the whole thing and say if there's some lessons that can be drawn from that?
I mentioned before where I got started and where I saw the groups come together is when you have a common issue, and sometimes, as the old Saul Alinsky organizer said, a common enemy. So it's real clear that as long as ethnic groups keep fighting each other, who's more deserving, you know, who's been more oppressed, it's a losing battle. Which isn't just that people have to talk about their own history of oppression and discrimination, and all the groups have that in common. There's no question about that. So then, you know, can you get together based on feeling that you have been also a victim and or been out of the loop, and how do you become a player? Here's a couple of things that I think are a little touchy that I don't want to end today, so maybe this will be my next to last comments as we do one more round, because I do have, you know, sort of the organizing solutions. But there is an ambivalence. You talked about some level of the new immigrants or attitudes of young folks today. And I think if we're talking about the Jewish community, and maybe, and it's true probably of a lot of ethnic groups, maybe the Chinese community, ambivalence about how much you want to assimilate. You know, and I think there is a continuing tension. and it's a tension between being on the inside and moving up, you know, and being proud of that, being the exception sometimes, you know, or being being part of the mainstream, and continuing to keep your identity and your roots. And I think that is a clear an issue for younger folks today, the organizers of today. And I don't think it needs to be an either or, but it's not just we can do both, but you really have to struggle with how much separation you want and how much integration. And I think that is something that the groups themselves have to, because you use the word enclaves, right, as opposed to ghettos, and how much of when people want to live with their own kind, that's a traditional history. You know, and so what is, you know, but yet with the Chinese, I know you've had the problem of trying to have representation in Congress and to try to introduce something called non-contiguous representation, right? Is that still on the table? Because you don't have one community. And I was fascinated with this discussion a couple of years ago about trying to make a district that wasn't even contiguous. You know how they draw the districts to get some.
They did. Yeah,
yeah, I know. Crooked, to get some
district.
To get some political power. So we're talking about lots of things here, but I do think that the issue of what does assimilation mean? Because I think you raised that question. I mean, I don't think everybody wants to assimilate. Well, first of all, people look a certain way, they're not going to assimilate if that means looking white, right? I mean, we have to deal with color. You know, I mean, the difference, it seems to me, between the Jews and the Asians is, I think, and again, this is coming from me, and I'd love to have people challenge it, Jews are a religion and a culture and have a historical identity often defined by the other, the Christian world. But, you know, the Chinese folks are part of a race, you know, and get called the yellow race.
Yeah, but that could be a perception.
I'm saying it's a perception. I'm not trying to...
It's not as a perception, because it's not. It's biological. But what happened with the Italians up to the 1940s became a perception. And it was probably true, because Sicily was invaded by, settled by, like, 300 cultures of all different colors. Right. We should all be rainbow. Right. But the fact is, we were labeled as a different class on our visas coming to this country. There's a category called Southern Italian race.
And we know it's political as much, if not more, than it is biological.